Hello, hello, and welcome to Temple of the False Pod, where decks are not optimized, but our plays sure as heck are fun. I'm Andy.
I'm Bruce.
Hold on. I just realized that I have the Zoom set up wrong. There we go.
Oh.
I had you on the left and me on the right. Welcome back. If this is not your first episode, if this is your first episode, welcome. We'd like to talk about commander stuff, magic stuff, casual stuff.
Stuff.
With the recent release of Eldraine, Wilds of Eldraine, we saw something familiar that we liked, which is just an excellent time all around to like something. Back in, I'm not even going to pretend to know what year. Commander Legends, the first Commander Legends, had this cycle of enchantments called courts. We had like Court of, I should have had this ready. Court of Ire. There we go. That's a one. Court of Ire. Three red red. When it enters the battlefield, you become the monarch. And then the whole cycle was at the beginning of your upkeep, this thing happens. But if you're the monarch still, a bigger thing happens. So with Court of Ire, it deals two damage to any target. You get a free shock. But if you're the monarch, you get seven. Seven total damage at a target. Either permanent or player. It's great.
Yes.
I was scrolling through all the new cards, as I like to do with especially the commander decks, for Wilds of Eldraine, and I realized, hey, there are five here that are courts. Now, I'll be honest, I don't know if these are in the commander decks. These might just be in like set boosters. You know how like the set boosters have like a slot that are like commander cards? And the only reason I say that is because I don't think all five colors are covered in the two commander decks. I think there's a green-white one and a black-blue one, so I don't think there's red. Because I was so excited about them, I was like, Bruce, we gotta talk about these. It's our favorite cycle. Well, it's my
absolutely
favorite cycle.
Do.
And they're expanding it. And I just love, I mean, we've talked about the past couple seasons how Wizards is evolving this game through multiplayer mechanics. And I think that these cycles are very much like this is how they are doing it, you know? Because it involves the monarch, and sure, like, these work fine in two-player games, but I think it creates like a whole new level of interaction for four-player games that are just excellent.
Yes. Every court card brings this new level, just a level of not only do you want to get the monarch so you can draw the card, but you need to get the monarch away from this person.
Mm.
And that's sort of, it's there all of the time.
Yeah.
And it's something to keep in mind. You know, if drawing the card alone isn't enough of an encouragement to swing, then preventing them from getting the extra ability on their upkeep should be. Because, you know, it really, really means it. I find that with the courts, it adds just that little bit more. So if you are, you know, if you're looking to really keep the monarch, the courts can be kind of dangerous because it really encourages your opponents to swing at you. However, it also guarantees that the monarch's going to start flying around the table really fast because somebody's going to try and stop you from getting this benefit. But hey, all the more reason for you to be gunning for it and having a lot more instant speed ways to become the monarch.
Oh, for sure. So. And I think one of my favorite things about this cycle is that you get the benefit regardless of if you're the monarch. It's just better if you're the monarch. So it's not a dead card by any means.
Yeah.
You're probably getting an initial monarch in there, which is great because then it's there throughout the game. And then you're also just like getting value. And I mean, with enchantment removal on the rise, like, sure, like there are ways to take care of it, but you've already done the damage, and like that's good enough. But figured we'd talk about these five cards. Talk about, you know, which ones we like more than the others. It's gonna be hard because I think they're all pretty cool. But I guess let's start with white, right?
Sure.
Court of Ardenvale, two white enchantment. Of course, when enters the battlefield, you become the monarch. At the beginning of your upkeep, return target permanent card with mana value 3 or less from your graveyard to your hand. If you're the monarch, return that permanent card to the battlefield instead. So, like, pretty cool. Does the white thing of like returning small things to your hand.
Right.
What I like about this card is that it says permanent, not non-land permanent. So, all else fails, get your Evolving Wilds back, you know? Yeah, I mean, it's in white. You're going to probably be doing white weenie stuff. Just bring back that stuff. And if you're still the monarch, I mean, this is 4 mana. Yeah, you probably have some blockers by this point.
So many people play Sun Titan. Sun Titan is a 6/6 creature that does this when it attacks.
Yeah.
Great. That's great. That's really good.
Unless you're attacking into Death Touchers.
But it does have to attack. Exactly. And this one does this and it just sits there. Now, I appreciate it doesn't always go into the battlefield. In fact, a lot of times it's not going to go into the battlefield. But man, plenty of time. A lot of times, we're talking about an artifact. This is a permanent with a mana value 3 or less. Even if it's going to your hand, it's only cost 3 to get it back out.
Yeah.
And you can put it out. If it goes back to the graveyard, you know you're getting it again.
Yeah.
Some kind of enter the battlefield trigger or whatever. You're looping this, and it's, you know, it's not going to be a game breaker, but that sort of stuff is, I just love that.
I think it's cool because, like, even more than the Monarch is already forcing your opponents to attack you, you know, like
yeah.
I've been in so many games where it's illogical for somebody to attack the Monarch other than the fact that they're the Monarch, you know, like they right. just have, like they're getting, you know, minor card draw. It's end of turn. Like there's so much that can be said about the Monarch, but there have been so many times that I'm like, threat assessment, that guy's not the issue. But I, with Court of Ardenvale, I feel like you can really... It's a lot easier to hold on to the Monarch because you're dealing with permanence. Right. So, like, especially later game, if you have, like, fewer opponents, this card specifically... it's just interesting because, like, you really have to have your opponents either ganging up on you to get the Monarch away from you, or have your opponents have a lot of creatures come at you, because if they're just coming at you with one thing, you just block regardless. If your thing dies, it's just going to come back
right
and onto the battlefield, because you are like, you're keeping the Monarch. It's good. I like it. This will definitely be going in a lot of my white decks.
Sure. Little funny thing that is not going to be relevant almost any of the time. Just so you know, Court of Garenbrig is the only court enchantment that we're going to discuss today that does cost 3 or less. Just saying.
Interesting.
Andy, what's the next one you want to talk about?
The blue one, of course.
Right.
Court of Vantress, 2 blue-blue. When Court of Vantress enters the battlefield, you become Monarch, of course. At the beginning of your upkeep, choose up to one other target enchantment or artifact. If you're the Monarch, you may create a token that's a copy of it. If you're not, Court of Vantress becomes a copy of it, except it has this ability. Or you may have it become a copy of it. That's pretty cool. Like, having it become a copy of it, of anything enchantment or artifact on the battlefield, is pretty neat. Like, just the copy alone, because, like, it could, you know, like, say we have it become, I don't know, name an artifact. Bolus' study. Okay, Rhystic Study, great. So have it become a Rhystic Study. Then, say, you know, the middle of your turn, you get rid of your opponent's Rhystic Study. Yours stays a Rhystic Study, and then next turn, you can keep it a Rhystic Study, because this is a May ability.
Yes.
And then, obviously, if you're the Monarch, then great. Like, you're just getting a token copy. It seems almost a little busted, if only because, like, I feel like there are a lot of artifacts and enchantments out there. Like, that covers a lot of the game. I feel like my mind is swimming with all the ideas of what you could really do with this.
Right. Well, I mean, the nice part is, like, if you're not the Monarch, if you're looking at the board and there's one particular artifact or enchantment that you want, the Court of Antris is going to work for you whether you're the Monarch or not, because you do get that one copy on your upkeep. The only question is, if you are the Monarch, then you're getting extras. Every turn you're the Monarch is essentially what it amounts to, because you make that token copy, and then it sits there, and now Court of Antris, the next turn, can become whatever else you want it to be. Or maybe you want another copy of that same thing. I mean, you know, if you can hang on to the Monarch for two turns, suddenly your opponent, who's got, I don't know, pick an artifact that is just truly misery, if I have three of them. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. The Cityscape Leveler.
Sure. Sure.
Meteor Golem.
Yeah. Right.
And that's the nice thing about the copies, too, is that you do get ETB effects, unlike having it turn into a copy.
Right. So there's that as well. But it's just, man, somebody's got to get the Monarch away from you, because this thing will be bad for opponents if they don't, on top of you drawing the extra card.
This, right. Oh my God. This in Bruticlad. Just like you just but, like, I mean, obviously,
because then you can get a token copy of any artifact out there, any one, it doesn't matter,
or enchantment.
What would you do with 15 copies of, I don't know, Ghostly Prison? I think no one's attacking you this for a while.
What's interesting too? Lock
things down.
Yeah, what's interesting too is that I believe if you target an aura, say, pacifism, if you have the Monarch, obviously it creates a token copy that I believe entering you can have it attached to anything.
Right.
If you have it become a copy of pacifism, I believe it will just go to the graveyard. So there are some little minute things that maybe don't copy, have it become a copy of. But
the other thing to keep in mind, doesn't have to be your stuff, or it can be your stuff. If that's something that you're aiming for with your deck, then obviously you can target your own stuff. But this is an easy way to open it up so that you can target other people's stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to read the next one?
Sure. Where are we here? Court of Wachthwain. For its 2BB. Whenever it enters the battlefield, you become the Monarch. At the beginning of your upkeep, exile the top card of target opponent's library. You may play that card for as long as it remains exiled, and mana of any type can be spent to cast it. If you're the Monarch, until the end of the turn, you may cast a spell from among cards exiled with Court of Lockwing without paying its mana cost. So now, not only do you have to take the Monarch away so they can't cast the cards for free, you have to keep the Monarch away. Because if they get it back a couple of turns later, and now they've got three different options of cards just sitting there waiting for them to cast it for free. Yeah. Ooh.
Yeah. It's interesting because, like, because it's a beginning of upkeep trigger.
Yeah.
I don't think the moment you become Monarch, you can start casting them for free. You have to wait for it to trigger again. But Like,
oh yeah.
It's weird. Like, it's personally, I think it's maybe the weakest out of the five. I mean, I know we're only halfway through, but like, I don't know. It's, I like it because it does the Gonti thing, but, repeatedly, which is nice, but it doesn't let you choose from like the top four like Gonti does. It's the top one. It lets you play lands, which is nice, but I don't know. I feel like it's got to be a deck that is more or less based around this type of thing.
Right.
And that's going to be a little bit more to get going. Because I don't know. It's fine. I think you're going to end up hitting, like, if it was the top card of every opponent's library, I think maybe, so that you have the selection, but I feel like you're going to whiff more often than not.
Well, I mean, it says cast a card, right? Or you may play that card for as long as it remains. Never mind.
Yeah. But, like, even hitting a land, like, at least you're doing it at the beginning of upkeep, so that, like, if you get a land, you can still play it. And not be like surprised by it, but I don't know, hitting a land every turn I feel like would feel like a whiff.
This is going to be one of those where it really is. I think it's very dependent on where you are in the game. If you can maintain the monarchy through your upkeep early in the game, well, then you can cast any of these any massive spell that normally you wouldn't be able to cast. If it's if we're later on, I appreciate the benefit of getting a card for free, even if you could afford to pay it. But the idea is that when you can't afford to pay it, it's generally not a card you're supposed to be able to get. It's going to be overpowered in comparison to what everybody else is getting, and that, so I think there's limited benefit there. In theory, you're probably not putting Court of Lochlin out until turn three or four at best, which means it's on turn four or five before you actually get to pull a card, hope it's something really, really good, and keep the monarch.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot of ifs there.
I think it also, and I also think it kind of depends on the meta. Like, we've talked about this before, where people build their decks for their decks, you know, like, like, there are a lot of, you know, five color good stuff type things. So at least you get to like target an opponent, but what are the chances that you hit a card that really only matters in that person's deck? But then the other side is twofold of one, they don't have that card anymore. It's exiled forever.
Yeah.
Well, I guess until you cast it. And two, you can cast that card even after Court of Lochthwain has been destroyed. Because it's just as long as it's exiled, you can cast it. So I mean, it's fine. but
yeah, I think this is fine. Honestly, I'll play it. I've always found that cards like this, to me, the focus is ramp. I'm going to find your lands. The cards that you have in your deck that I am going to be very interested in are going to be the ones that let me ramp.
Yeah.
Whether they're mana rocks or spells that let me search for land or whatever. We all know that we can all use those. It's when you get into some of the specific cards that are especially good for your deck, but maybe not quite so good in mine. So.
Yeah. And that's kind of like where the nice thing about the fact that you can use mana of any type to cast it is good. So like you can cast like Rampant Growth if you don't have green. But you have to be careful because you can't activate abilities of that card as if they were of any color. So like if you, you know, play, I don't know, like something with like a red ability, like you can't unless you have red. But that's where treasures and stuff come in. So
exactly.
The next one is Court of Embereth, 2 red-red. When it enters the battlefield, you become the monarch. Surprise! At the beginning of your upkeep, create a 3/1 red knight creature token. Then, if you're the monarch, Court of Embereth deals X damage to each opponent, where X is the number of creatures you control. This is cool. it's very interesting because the higher the X is, the higher likely chance you will still be Monarch when it comes back around. This is very nifty, especially in Goblin colors. I don't know, man.
Is this a win more card?
It might be. It might be a win condition, honestly, because you get to not attack. You create a 3-1.
Damage to each opponent. That's just you building a wall.
Yeah.
I just have to survive, and I just have to, you know, keep the Monarch.
You got to find flyers, and that's about it. Like
that many turns. Yeah.
A 3-1's nice. It doesn't have haste, which is weird, but I don't know. You don't really need it to have haste.
Red white soldier flyers.
There you go.
You don't even have to swing anymore.
This would be great in Kaikar. There's not much to say about this one. Getting a 3-1 every turn for free is fine.
I do think that if that's all you're getting, like if you're not going to be able to hang on to the Monarch, I just don't know that 4 mana for a 3-1, even multiple 3-1s, is going to be enough. I mean, they don't... 3-1s block once. So I don't know if that is enough for me. But I don't know. This is one of those ones I think I need to play it.
Yeah. A little... But, like, I mean, they can't all be, you know, bangers, so...
Right, and I... Yeah. This is...
Yeah. I think
this could be very good... And I can see times when it is, you're just going to pull this card and just be like, no.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, good. I become the Monarch. I get to draw for a turn. Somebody smokes me over the head. And then on my upkeep, I get a 3-1.
I think the fact that we don't have a lot to say about this card kind of
says a lot about this card.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to read the last one?
All right, last one. Court of Garenbrig for 1 and 2 green. This is the cheapest. This is the only one that doesn't cost 4. When it enters the battlefield, you become the Monarch. At the beginning of your upkeep, distribute 2 +1/+1 counters among up to 2 target creatures. Then, if you're the Monarch, double the number of +1/+1 counters on each creature you control. So, for this one, take your 2 +1/+1 counters, put them wherever, and if you happen to be the Monarch, you can double all of the +1/+1 counters. I appreciate that this only costs 3 because if you play it out on turn 3, you're likely only doubling those 2 counters you just put out. But realistically, you're not putting this in a deck unless that deck is making a lot of +1/+1 counters because there's a chance you're going to get to double all of them. This is a freaking... house. But you have to hold on to the Monarch, and I just don't know how hard that's going to be.
It's interesting because this is, I mean, other than the blue one, this requires more from you. The blue one requires more from the table, but this one requires more from you. Like, you can't have just this enchantment out.
Right.
Which kind of bites. Oh,
yeah.
But I mean, if you're playing a +1/+1 counter deck, you have other things on the table. So, like, it'll be fine.
Right. And honestly, you just need one creature out when you're doing this.
And the fact that it's double on each of the creatures is a little crazy. Because green is the color of trample.
It just takes one count. You just need to spread them around a little. Cards like Court of Garenbrig, man, this is what the Ozolith was made for.
Yeah. there's a card I'm looking for. What is it?
At the beginning of your upkeep, distribute 2 +1/+1 counters on Triskelion that you control.
There you go.
Double those counters.
Any of the Pentavis cycle.
Any of those ones that lets you take a plus one plus one counter off to do something gets nasty with cards like this. I look at Court of Garenbrig and I see a card for 3 mana, and if I can keep it out for, well, you're going to play it, you're going to be the monarch, you're going to draw a card. So at worst, you're going to draw a card to replace this card. If it can hang around for 2 more upkeeps and you're not the command and you are not the monarch, I think I'm happy paying 4 mana for 2 plus one hustle counters on consecutive upkeeps. I think that would be my break even on this card. So I'm not
and it's
sure
only
why
3.
I wouldn't. Right. I really like this one. I think it's very nice.
For sure.
So Andy.
Yeah.
Rank them. What's number 5? What's the worst one?
I'm going with the black one for me. See, which is upsetting because
right. And I'm going to go with Court of Embereth. I think it's. I just don't think that token is just going to be worth it. My number 4, however, is going to be Court of Lothwain.
My number four is Court of Embereth. I think
we both agree these are the bottom end of it. My number 3, in spite of what I just said, would be Court of Garenbrig. It's definitely better than the black and the red and the black one, but I don't think it's the idea that blue is recurring a card either to your hand or to the battlefield.
White.
I'm taking that. White is. And blue is either getting you something that you want or making a copy of something you want. Those are both far better than what Court of Garenbrig is doing.
I mean,
in the right place in the right time, the court could explode. But that's a lot to ask.
I think Garenbrig... I don't know. This one's tough for me for the third one because I think the top 3 are so good at what they do. I think I would be worried about Court of Garenbrig if only because I think people would see it and be like, that's a really powerful card. I'm going to kill it. So like you wouldn't get like I feel like the other two you could at least get a couple activations off of it.
Right.
I feel like people see plus one counters or like doubling things and they're like, that's got to go.
Got to go.
I had all 3 of them out, I feel like the choice would be, I got to get rid of the green one first. Not my choice.
By the way, in case you're wondering, the Court of Garenbrig, if you have doubling season out and you're the monarch, it says then you double the number of counters. It's not so much doubling as adding that many more. And when you're adding that many, doubling season says, "Oh, you're adding double that."
So it's triple.
So if a creature had two counters on it, instead of getting 2, it would get 4.
So now it's up to 6.
Just throwing that out there for you, folks.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. So Andy, who's your what's your number 3?
I gotta go with Court of Garenbrig.
All right, Andy, number 2.
Who's your number 2? My number 2 will probably Court of Vantress. I really like its effect, but I mean, same thing I said about the green one. It requires something of someone rather than like, I don't know, I guess Court of Ardenvale does too. Like it requires you to have stuff in the graveyard. I'm changing my mind. Number 2 is Court of Ardenvale.
Yep, Ardenvale was my number 2. I think it's an amazing card. Definitely want to get it, but it's only working if you have stuff in the graveyard.
Yeah.
And it has to be 3 mana or less. So that's about the only restriction. I think Court of Vantress, by the time you can afford to play it out, there's stuff out there that you're going to want to copy.
Yeah.
And I'll take that. So.
And like with Court of Ardenvale, I mean, like, it requires you to have something in the graveyard that's 3 or less.
Yeah.
But what I like so much about it is that, much like the best planeswalkers, it protects itself for the most part. Because if you are getting that recursion, then it forces your opponent to continue feeding into that loop. Because otherwise you'll start actually getting value out of it. But
yeah,
yeah, no, the blue one, like, you're upping your game. You are adding to your plays rather than, like, keeping the monarch at you. Like, you are just, like, you're using the toolbox of everyone rather than just kind of,
you know,
spinning.
Worst case scenario for Court of Vantress?
He has Soul
I'm
Ring.
I'm getting a bonus Soul Ring. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I get something that I can tap for two mana every turn. Oh, and by the way, on the next turn, if I happen to be the monarch, then I create a copy of anything. Worst case scenario, I'm going to create a copy of Soul Ring. Now I've got that one and maybe another one if the Court of Antra sticks around for another turn. There are just too many good ways to make that work. And, of course, folks, as always, there's a caveat. These cards are only as good as your meta will let them be.
Right.
If your meta is flying and games are wrapping by turn 7 and 8, well then yeah, the courts are not going to be as exciting because you really want to activate once or twice. So
yeah.
But for us, for me, this is where I love it. This is right where I want to be. So
for sure. But yeah, I mean, I think that does it for us today. We love this. I love this. I'm so excited. But yeah, that'll do it for us this week. Next week, we have another cool topic, which, I mean, the Monarch kind of plays into as well. Card draw. So we'll see you then. Because we're Temple of Falsepod, where decks are not optimized, but our plays sure as heck are fun. I'm Andy.
I'm Bruce.
Thank you so much for hanging out. Thank you so much for watching or listening. Or taking us in however you do. Play some magic for me. Have a great night, and may your fifth land be the temple.
Bye.
Wait, before you go, just wanted to say thank you for listening. You can reach out to us via email at falsepodmtg@gmail.com or on Twitter at falsepodmtg. Bruce is at ManaBurned, and I'm at AndyWeekend, though you'll definitely notice I use the podcast Twitter far more often. Now that we've got you here, make sure you subscribe, like, rate us on whatever podcast platform you use. It helps us out. It gets us more reach. Subscribe to us on our YouTube channel. Like a video there. Leave some comments for more casual enjoyment. Thank you so much for listening. We'll be back with some more timeless discussions about all things casual. So come hang out, and may your fifth land be the temple. Bye-bye. Should I do my best, Bruce?
Bye!